All right, so good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining us for a really exciting webinar today with Jeff Bucholtz. I will let him do more introductions of himself, but this is Kelly at WCASA, and we have almost our whole staff here in our training room, so we're all really excited to hear from Jeff along with you. So again, if you have questions about during the presentation, you can go ahead and type those in, and we will monitor those and get those to Jeff. If you're having any tech issues, you can put those in as well, and Rose will help you, not me. We're going to get started. So again, good morning. Thanks for joining us, and I'll turn it over to Jeff.
All right. Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining. Repeat that. I'm really excited to kind of be here with you virtually, so I know you can see me. I can't see you, but I hope you're having a good day. I'm going to jump in today and just kind of start getting raring and ready to go. And I'll do that a little bit by introducing myself. I know there's probably a lot of you out there who have met me before, but just in case you have not. Mm-hmm. So I'm Jeff Bucholtz, and I'm one of the directors of We End Violence. Carol Mosley is the other director. She's based in Montgomery. I'm in San Diego. Mm-hmm. And We End Violence provides a lot of different services, including consultation, performances, materials, resources. And our goal is basically to simplify the dialogue around sexual violence prevention, domestic violence, stalking, all those kind of things. And we also have an online program called Agent of Change, which is our interactive online training program. And it is designed for college-aged people, so kind of like 16 to 24-year-olds. And it is a virtual environment. Oh, I have to turn off my webcam now. Goodbye. But you can still hear me. So.
Because of the delay.
Oh, all right. So we'll just now you don't get to see me anymore. I get back in my pajamas. All right. So, so Agent of Change is designed as kind of like a role playing game, like a video game. And so users get in there, they have opportunities to interact with these virtual characters and make choices and have learned bystander intervention and violence prevention skills. So it's something else that we provide. We work with communities, the military, college campuses. Lots of things that we can provide. If you're ever interested, please feel free to reach out. So today we are going to be talking about rape culture. So up on the screen you'll see rape culture. And instead of me just going ahead and giving a definition of this, I'd like you all to use your chat function right now. I want you to just send in what you think, how you would define rape culture, or something that you think is a critical piece of what we call rape culture. So you want to take a second and just send in those ideas, your thoughts. We'll take a look and share what you're thinking.
I'm so sorry, but
the sound.
If you can just talk a little bit slower.
I can.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. And what do you need right now?
So some answers that we're seeing is a culture that is not shocked by rape, acceptance of violence against women, blaming and questioning the actions of the victim more than the perpetrator, a culture that supports perpetration and questions victims, the environment we live in. Lots of great answers coming. Keep them coming. Love everyone using their features there. Can't really understand.
A lot of people can't understand Kelly, but that's okay.
I will speak a little closer to the microphone. So again, a lot of things about blaming and questioning, normalization of rape in our society due to attitudes about gender and sexuality.
A lot of really great answers. So Well, you can keep submitting stuff, and we'll kind of come back to them, but I'll go ahead and continue here. And I think that those are a lot of really solid suggestions as to what rape culture is. And there is no one definition for rape culture. The way that I tend to look at it is that it's an environment in which rapists can operate and survivors feel shamed. It's the environment that we create that allows rape to happen. And all the things that you all suggested are pieces of that. And that's in part what we're going to look at today. And I think that anytime we're trying to educate and spread awareness around sexual violence prevention or survivor support, it's really important to actually think about what creates the environment, right? What rape culture looks like as we talk about that, regardless of the type of work we're doing. So this, to me, if we were to sum up rape culture, I think this cycle that you see up on the screen now is a big piece of that. That rape culture is an environmental thing where we're disrespect, we're seeing people as less, being able to dehumanize them based on their gender, their race, leads to violation. And this is a really common cycle that we see all around humanity for a very long time. If I see you as less, hurting you gets easier. And rape culture is kind of the thing that fuels that disrespect, right? It's all the things that create that cycle and have it moving in that way. Another way to think about rape culture, this is the funnel of violence. For those of you who aren't familiar, Larry Cohen of the Prevention Institute out in Berkeley, this is one of the models that they use to talk about, I'm going to say rape culture, but a culture of violence. And the idea here you can see, again, is kind of like that violence doesn't happen in a vacuum, that it's facilitated by the environment, it's facilitated by the culture. And so all these pieces that kind of go together to spit out the rape that we see in the environments around us. Here's something I want to kind of touch on quickly, because I think that it's also important to recognize why talking about rape culture is relevant and important to the work that we do. This is a little kind of maze here, right? If we say, what are we all working on? And it's simply to end violence and certainly support people who are victims of violence. And so what is necessary for that to occur? And so there's kind of these three pieces that have to happen. The first thing that a lot of people, and I'm sure many of you hear this, is people want to hold perpetrators accountable. And that is a very good idea, to hold them accountable and ideally get them treatment and all those kind of things. That's a difficult task, in particular when people don't have a strong understanding of what sexual assault is. And it can't happen alone. So you see on the right there the idea of supporting survivors. So obviously we can't hold perpetrators accountable if survivors don't come forward and share with us what's happening. And a rape culture is a place where they're less likely to do that. And then for survivors to feel supported, what we really need is kind of improving community understanding. Again, the idea here being that people aren't going to be supportive when they don't even understand what sexual assault is, when they have stereotypes and beliefs and myths that kind of like fuel what they think about it. And let me give you kind of like an example of how this worked in San Diego County. So in San Diego County, there was a sexual assault case, as you all, many of you are familiar with, an intox case, a case where there was alcohol present. And in this case that went to trial, there were the basics of the case were a woman who was sexually assaulted while extremely intoxicated at a party. In the trial, there are several witnesses that testify, in particular these two witnesses who actually viewed the woman being sexually assaulted. So her best friend went into the room looking for her and couldn't and saw her being raped by this guy. And then the guy shoved her out of the room, so she leaves the room. And then she gets another guy who comes with her back, and they go in the room. He sees the unconscious woman being sexually assaulted, testifies to this in court. There were other witnesses from the party that she was at. There was even some video footage that showed her leaning on a wall. She couldn't stand. There was the medical, the medical evidence, and that her BAC was, well over intoxicated. And so all of this evidence is presented in a courtroom. And then the jury comes back hung. And it was hung 4-8, with 8 in favor of acquittal. And so when I think of something like that, which to most of us is like, how in the world could that be a not guilty charge? You've got everyone there going, everyone knows this woman was unable to consent, that this was a sexual assault. How does that happen? And the answer to that is that not all of these pieces are happening. That the 12 people sitting in that jury box holding perpetrators accountable is not a realistic solution until the 12 people sitting in that box don't believe that kind of girl who goes out in front of, using the air quotes here, you can't see him, but that kind of girl who goes out and gets drunk like that is someone who, is kind of setting herself up, or she's asking for trouble. And I mean, clearly that's a big piece of what those 8 people who are looking at an acquittal with all of that evidence in front of them are thinking. And that is why this is relevant to everyone. So if you're doing survivor support work, understanding rape culture and being able to communicate about it is critical to supporting the people you work with, because that's the environment they're surviving in. If you want to hold perpetrators accountable, it's necessary for that. And so education really becomes an important piece of that. And it's something that we talk about a lot, because prevention and education seem kind of like they can be separated out. You've got prevention, and then you've got intervention or support. And what I'm trying to argue here, suggest, is that in a rape culture, those things are inseparable. That we can't see prevention and intervention as two separate entities. They are one and the same. They're connected. I mean, there are different practices that we use, et cetera, but they're really critical to being able to end a rape culture. So let me give you this as another example. I said that rape culture was an environment where rape was prone to happen. So, for example, when I go and I present on military bases, I ask a very simple question. Does sexual assault happen on your base? And regardless of who I'm speaking to, whether it be, you know, first-term airmen or soldiers or whether it's leadership, the response is consistent. They say, yes, it does. And then I ask another question. Are survivors always supported by the people around them on your base? And the answer, again, is no, they are not. And so what I remind them of is, okay, so your base is an environment where rapists feel able to operate and survivors feel unsafe to come forward. And these are the different pieces, and there are more pieces than these, by the way, but these are some of the pieces that kind of contribute to that. What is it that creates an environment where a rapist has, you know, that license to operate, that ability to operate? That is kind of the core of rape culture. So we've got a bunch here, and I'm going to go through these kind of quickly, and then as we're limited on time with the webinar, I won't kind of cover all of these as we go through, but I want to touch on them each right now. So we talk about rape jokes. I was just at a Madison West High School yesterday, and when I asked the students, the boys and the women's and men's clubs there, about when they try to educate their fellow students, what challenges they face, what they said was a lot of stuff around rape jokes and language. And I asked them, what does that sound like? And they said that they constantly hear people say, still, that test raped me. I've heard people say, my burrito got raped of cheese. So that's not necessarily like a ha-ha joke. If you're a Tosh.0 fan, you might be familiar with some rape jokes that he's used that are not at all funny or appropriate. But the joking is not just kind of like a knock-knock, who's there joke, but those things that we say that are meant to be funny, where rape is at the core of that. And so we want to make sure, like, as we're thinking about how to end a rape culture, we've got to address that piece. Media plays a large role, and any of you who've seen me present and know about the work that I do, I teach classes on popular culture, and I think it's pretty easy to see that media plays a very large role in promoting rape culture. We will spend some time focusing on that. There's also blame or victim blaming. So, you know, victim blaming, shaming people who come forward is a really common practice, obviously, in our culture and contributes to this environment. And then there's that one that says support. Blame and support go together, obviously. You know, people are less likely to seek support when they're afraid that they will be blamed. But support is also, what support systems do we have set up for people? All of you sitting on this webinar are people set up to provide that type of support. But if I were to ask you a question about how much support in your community outside of the work you do is available to the people you serve, my guess is that we would get a response that it's not as much as you would like, or it's not as much as is needed. And certainly when we talk about support from friends and family, that's not something that everyone is kind of prepared to do. So even if you wouldn't blame a victim, if you don't know how to provide support when someone discloses to you that they're sexually assaulted, that makes them less likely to seek help. It makes them less likely to move forward with a prosecution if they chose to do that. So that's that support category. Rumors we have on here, Carol, who's the other director of We End Violence, Carol talks about this a lot because rumors is kind of our way of talking about the way people talk about rape stories. So in your own communities, when a sexual assault happens, what is the conversation that ensues after that? How do people talk about it? What rumors spread about the people that were involved in the assault, in particular the victim? What rumors spread about them? What kind of person are they? What are their normal behaviors? And that those rumors about sexual assault, and also rumors about statistics or causes, so there's a lot of, you know, for example, biological determinism, right? A fancy term to basically say that it's our biology that causes men to rape or something like that. That's part of the rumor mill as well. Well, you know that's part of men's biology. They're prone to do that, which is not true, in case you're unclear on that. But that those rumors are a big part of what fuels rape culture. Harassment, and by that I do mean like kind of discrimination and harassment, sexual harassment, street harassment, contributes to rape culture because it's something that is all about dehumanization. It's about seeing people as less. It's about power and control. It's about, you know, sexism and those components. So harassment plays a big role. The DoD did a study back in 2004 where they were looking at sexual assault on military bases, and what they found was that on bases with sexual harassment, where sexual harassment was present and the reports of sexual harassment were high, that sexual assault was four times more likely to occur, which for most of you, again, listening to this, is not a terrible shock. We've got language and the way that we use language, so the way that we talk about survivors, the language we use around masculinity, femininity, gender, all those kind of things play a role. We're going to focus on that a bit. We've got consent, which is a big piece, obviously, of what sexual assault is about. And, you know, in our culture, how do people talk about consent? How do we think about consent? How do we get consent? How do we share and teach our kids to get consent and talk about consent? So that's a piece of that rape-prone environment. And then the last one on here is oppression. And by that, it's just kind of a reminder that, anything that dehumanizes or makes any group of people less increases the likelihood that they will be violated or hurt. So that would include racism and sexism and homophobia and ableism and all of those things in our environment that, allow someone to see another person as less. So that's kind of dull and straightforward, but I wanted to kind of to dive into that just for a second so you can see the different pieces that we're looking at here. By the way, as a kind of first step, if you wanted to have a conversation, if you were doing prevention work, let's say in a high school, this is a really easy way to do it. So you can step into a classroom and you come in with one example of each of these categories, and then you ask the students to come up with more for you. You talk about what those things tell us and what that would say to a rapist and what it would say to a survivor. And that is a simple 60-minute activity that really gives them kind of a context for what their role is in ending it, what causes it, how we prevent it, all of those kind of things. And obviously it gives you an opportunity to focus on support and blame, which is useful for young people to learn as well. So when I think of a rape culture, this is another way that, I do this activity, in particular with adults. So we'll put this up on a screen and ask, what does a sexual assault look like? You can certainly also solicit, you know, ask the question, solicit the answers, but these are what most people, what we know a sexual assault actually looks like, right? These are some of the facts that we as practitioners know about sexual assault. It's almost always someone you know. Often there's a lack of physical evidence. There's no weapon. There's delayed reporting. There's not obvious physical injury. Alcohol and drug use are part of it, or are used as weapons against victims. So I say, what does this have to do with rape culture? Now I want to show you that when you ask this question in a lot of rooms, and I've done this a lot of times, and Carol designed this next slide from 30 years of experience in the field, and this is what people say a sexual assault looks like. And I just kind of want to give you a second to look at that list, because that list obviously is, I wouldn't say every myth, but certainly a lot of myths and ideas and stereotypes that fuel victim blaming, they fuel perpetrator support. Men who have girlfriends don't rape. Men just get carried away. That one drives me crazy because it makes all men basically walking rape machines. You know, and we're just lucky if we don't get triggered by some girl walking by. Which, by the way, if any of you are male-identified listening to this, that should really upset you if it doesn't yet already. And for those of you who aren't male-identified but hang out with people who are, that's something to remind them of, that the idea that men can't control themselves, that men are always thinking about sex, men can't, that this is something that men just get carried away with our sexual, our sexual desires, is a really messed up and creepy thing to say, and it's really insulting to men. And it's something that a lot of men begin to identify with, and they can say, yeah, that is messed up because I'm not a rapist. You say, great, why don't we make sure to articulate that more often? But it's this binary, almost like this dichotomy between what sexual assault actually looks like and then the stereotypes about it that fuel it in our environment. So let's kind of get started in going through on some things that we can practically do, to some activities and ideas on how we can address some of these areas. So the first one we're going to do is media. So as we go through these different categories, we'll start with media. And so I'm going to do a little poll here right now, ask you all a question. Rose is going to bring that up for us. So if you would answer this poll, please.
Still so you can see the results up on the screen.
All right, yeah, no, I can see that.
No, but they can't.
No, they can't see it.
Okay, so we have 10% of people. Thank you. 2% of people said 10%, 7% of people said 25%. About 1 out of 5 of you said half of all songs contribute to rape culture. 50% said that was 75. And again, 1 in 5 of you said that 90% of songs are contributing to rape culture.
So the correct answer is there is no correct answer. You know, I was asking this question, and it's kind of an interesting thing to see. You know, I mean, when I asked that question of people in this field, and you see people saying that 75% of songs contribute to rape culture, I think obviously the first question we have to ask is which songs, which genre of music, what you know, because there are differences across different genres. But the point here, right, is that it even at the lowest end, right, where it's 10%, that would mean that 10%, one out of every 10 songs that you listen to, that a young person listens to, that a survivor listens to, that a rapist listens to, is contributing to an environment, right, where rape is more likely to happen. And so that, for me, is a pretty alarming thing to think about. To dive into this a little bit, we're going to go through a song, a kind of sample of this. And I want to give you all a bit of a trigger warning and kind of an awareness warning. I'm going to play a video right now. It is, if you haven't seen it yet, it is Maroon 5's hit song, Animals. It's kind of the video playing with the lyric beneath it. The video is graphic, so I just kind of want to prepare you for that.
Yeah.
So here we're back. The internet and all of those things kind of make it sound a little bit hard. If you haven't heard the song before, it is a very catchy tune. It plays all over the radio constantly. And I apologize to those of you who will now be singing animals, 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 moles. Although that is my favorite part of the song, by the way, is, you know, at some point, you know, they were like, they had an extra beat. They're like, what are we going to do with that extra beat? Let's just add another moles to the song, you know. And I want to play this. I mean, the video obviously is very graphic and incredibly creepy and incredibly disturbing. And so what is that and how does it contribute to a rape culture? So first of all, I think that the first thing I'd just like to say is that media, while it is a source of rape culture, is also an incredibly powerful place for us to talk about that culture because it's common. It's common body of knowledge stuff. So when I go into a high school or a college campus, or I'm talking to, you know, and you play music that they're familiar with, and it's important to pick music that fits your group. If I'm talking to a group that is not going to be listening to, you know, hip-hop, I don't use hip-hop. I use something that's more likely that they'll, something that they'll be listening to. But you can play a Frank Sinatra song and find plenty of misogyny and plenty of rape culture. So it exists in a lot of different genres. So this is an opportunity for people to interact. The Air Force is now doing this because we've been doing training with the Air Force for so long and doing so much karaoke with them that they are now incorporating it into their actual official trainings because it's such an effective tool to get people to think about this stuff. So if we go ahead here, I want to show you the... So in writing the lyric for the song, and I think it's kind of important to think about the song for a second. I don't know if you noticed that, but the lyric has that. Baby, I'm preying on you tonight, hunt you down, eat you alive, just like animals, animals. The animals part, I think, is a really important piece for us to look at in terms of rape culture, because that idea of animal, like when we are sexual, we are like animals, is a really important discourse, a really important idea that functions in our culture, that fuels perpetrators in particular, which is the idea that sex is basically out of our control, that we are like, we are like animals. So when things become sexual, it's just, it's uncontrollable. And obviously that's a pretty rapey idea. And that song just keeps repeating it over and over and over again. And obviously it gets creepier as it goes along. So the next thing I want to talk about here is blame and victim blaming and some things you might be able to do around that. And we'll have some more media examples later. But again, I would encourage you to think about media as a useful tool. So my graphic was intended to work differently this, but now we're on blame, and I've got to go through all of them again because that's how that worked out. So we're talking about blame. So I'll start off with this this slide, hookup culture, alcohol, and victim blaming. And I want to go back to that sexual assault case that I was mentioning from San Diego County, and that a big piece of what that's about is this notion that there are some types of people, some types of women in particular, who are more likely to be sexually assaulted than others, that they put themselves in those kind of situations. And currently in our environment, one of the pieces of that is this idea of hookup culture. Because there's kind of this conceptualization that hookup culture now is so different than it used to be, and that people are hooking up left and right now. And when we actually do studies of this, right, on college campuses, for example, you know, I ask how many people think that hookup culture happens often, and the response is often, you know, 50%, 70% of the time. But you're talking about 8 to 10% of students who regularly engage in hookups. So there's a disconnect between what's actually happening and what we think is happening. But this idea of hookup culture is that our young people today, many of you have heard this, young people today, they just hook up everywhere as if people haven't been hooking up, I'm using air quotes again, forever, right? I mean, I'm sure some of you out there have hooked up with someone before, and that it's just that we change the way we talk about it so that younger people talk about it in a way that sounds really casual, but it's not as if they're practicing and engaging in casual sex as such 10 times more than people were in the past. People have been having sex, obviously, for a very long time. So this isn't, and I bring this up because it's an important thing when we're talking in particular with parents and adults, because what I find that they do is they perpetuate rape culture by throwing in this idea that young people are part, they just hook up and it's all casual and that's why rape happens. And that idea is really dangerous and really damaging, because obviously if you're a survivor and you hear someone say that, the implication is that it's because you wanted to hook up with someone is why you got sexually assaulted, why that person decided to hurt you. When you mix in alcohol into that, and you can see the two images I picked here, one, the movie Spring Break, which I do not actually recommend watching. It's really quite terrible. And I'm sorry if some of you like that movie. It's my opinion that it's terrible. I should express that. And then this is a Spring Break site that I pulled up. And you can, if you just type in like Spring Break party, right, or Spring Break events, it is incredible what the websites show on those web pages. And what they typically show is, as you see in these two images here, are women. Young women who are sexualized and sexually accessible. And there's usually a guy or a couple of guys who look very happy, as this young guy does on the bottom right, to be surrounded by a bunch of young women in bikinis and, I'm guessing, a hot tub. And the idea here, right, is like, what is that environment like, you know, where people go out and they get drunk and they hook up and you know, they start drinking, and what kind of girl, what kind of guy, what kind of person is the person who goes out, gets drunk like that, and ends up hooking up? And that is exactly, right, what we, in that first rape case I was talking about, that case from San Diego, is exactly what that jury's thinking. They looked at this young woman and they saw that idea of a woman engaging in a normal, casual hookup culture, and of course the guy who they're saying is like, well, he was drunk, she was drunk, this is just alcohol and hookup culture, because these young kids today don't set boundaries like we used to, which is kind of comical when you think about that. Now there's actually a lot more, you know, people have a lot more capacity, use that fancy word, right, to set boundaries in a lot of ways that they didn't before, especially young women. That while there's a lot of confusion around that a lot of women feel a lot more empowered to say, hey, get off me, go away, where 50, 60 years ago that would not have been the case as often. And then the piece of victim blaming down there, obviously, is kind of like, oh, so what is this all about? It's all about finding ways to blame victims. And so when we talk about hookup culture as if it's this real thing that has shifted, you know, shifted the way sex happens entirely, when we talk about alcohol as if it is the cause of rape and that if people didn't just get drunk, everything would be fine, that is what fuels victim blaming. I'm going to put some images up here again. I want to just give, another trigger warning. These are tweets and posts that came up after the Steubenville, as part of the Steubenville case. And as I put these up here, I'll give you a second to read them. It's really sad to read and really hard to read. So if you want to check out a couple of those. So I saw a presentation today by Maria Shermer out of the Dane County Rape Crisis Center. She was one of the other guest speakers at Madison West yesterday, and she used quotes from the Steubenville case as well. And I'd encourage a lot of you, especially if you're doing prevention education, this is a really powerful tool, because this isn't so much necessarily even about what the Steubenville case was. And if you're not familiar, quickly, right, it was a sexual assault, a gang rape in Pennsylvania, and there were tons of witnesses to it. And then afterwards, this is what was coming out about the case. And it's a really powerful place for us to talk about what blaming and shaming really looks like, and what entitles someone to be able to write something like, I have no sympathy for whores, and what that means to a survivor, obviously, and what that means, you know, so it's not just the victim of the specific sexual assault who's harmed by this. Obviously, anyone who's online and sees any of this go up, who's got any even semblance of empathy for what a victim might be going through, or they themselves have been through something, see this, and all of that shame and blaming just comes right back out into the front. And obviously online, people are willing to post things they're not typically allowed to post. They wouldn't necessarily say in person, and that is part of the problem with online spaces, that people feel kind of even more entitled to be really cruel to each other. But these are things that I'm sure a lot of you have heard people say out loud in public spaces. You've heard family members say things like these. And so what I wanted to kind of point out here, right, is that you can bring this up and ask questions as simple as, if you were a survivor of sexual assault and you saw this, what would it change for you about who you would talk to and what kind of resources you would look for, those kind of things. So I want to show you kind of like an activity is a pretty simple way to do this. So most survivors don't tell anyone. This is a sad reality, right? Most survivors don't tell anyone about a sexual assault. If you are working in spaces where you have a lot of potential perpetrators, I'm not sure which spaces those would be specifically, but if you thought you were in a space like that, I would probably avoid stating that most survivors don't tell anyone, because that would be a kind of dangerous thing to do. But this is a really powerful strategy for talking about rape culture. Most survivors don't tell anyone. You say that out loud. You can use a statistic if you'd like, but you really don't have to. You say, in my work, in my experience, most survivors are afraid to tell people. They don't tell anyone. And then we ask the follow-up question, why? Why is that? So I'm actually going to ask you all this question right now. Most survivors don't tell anyone. Why? Give us a couple of simple reasons as to why they don't like to tell people. If you can put that in your chat.
Fear of not being believed, fear, shame, blame, be judged further, afraid of what people will say or judge, victim blaming, won't be believed, loss of relationships, how people will look at them, shame, fear being blamed, ashamed, called sluts and whores, scared to cause problems for the perpetrator, fear of judgment by peers, retaliation, victim blaming, shaming.
Okay, so that's a pretty good summary, and obviously not a hard question for any of you who do advocacy work to answer. You know, these are really common responses. So that's the first part of the question, and here's the second part. So typically, I'm modeling what we would do in a kind of conversation about this. And this can be done, by the way, in kind of like long-term recovery work with the survivor as well, who's struggling with why they didn't tell people. So let's take one of those things that was repeated a lot. Kelly, what do you think the most popular response there was?
Fear of being blamed.
Okay, fear of being blamed. So the next step to this is to ask a question and say, and I'm going to ask you all to do this, can you give me a specific example of what that blame would sound like? Who it would come from, what it might sound like, anything you've heard in your work, just what would that, like, let's get a concrete example. What does that blaming look like? What does that blaming sound like?
Are you sure you didn't lead him on? What were you wearing? Why did you get so drunk? It's my fault. I got so drunk. You shouldn't have. ... She was so drunk. She had a relationship with him. Why did you wear that? What were you doing there? Any kind of why questions.
Okay, so that's a good sample. So what we would be doing, let's say you were working with a group, a community group, and you were just trying to do some basic awareness and get them, you know, ready to do a little bit more survivor support just in their own lives. So you would open up again with this question, why don't survivors tell people? They'll give you the kind of answers typically that you all replied with. Then we get more specific and say, okay, what does that actually sound like? And often I'd suggest you write this down somewhere if you can, you know, on a easel or dry erase board, something like that. You just write down what their responses are. This in and of itself, by the way, is enough. This can be an hour-long discussion just from what comes up on that board, because you can take that and just run with it and say, okay, let's talk about one of these comments. For example,
what were you doing there?
Okay, what were you doing there? So you can take that question and ask, right? what is that question meant to imply? You know, and you can have people talk about that she went in there, and so why would anyone go there? And then the question is, well, what does that lead a survivor to feel like? What is someone who's been victimized going to feel when they hear that? Then you come back to where you started, right? The shame, the blame, all of those kind of things. And you can take that, for example, and in that room, then talk about, is there anything that you could do? So let's say you're sitting in the room, and it's your cousin who does this. And if you want to solicit from people, where did you hear that specific comment? They say, oh, it was my best friend, or oh, it was this person. You can put that up on the board as well, and then ask them. The next step to that question is, okay, so now we've kind of identified why that is messed up. I'm using a polite term, right? Why that is messed up. And the follow-up question to that is, all right, if you're in the room and your cousin says that, let's talk about some basic things you might be able to do to respond to that. Is there anything you could say that might make the victim in the room feel more supported? Is there anything that they that you could do that would indicate to them just your basic displeasure with what they're saying? Are there any questions you might ask that would get them to think about that? Again, this is just an idea to get these folks involved in what they might be able to do. So here's another way so that would be kind of a first step. But if you wanted to build on that, here's another thing that you can do. So we'll act this out again. So imagine you are a survivor of rape. What are five things that you might need to help you recover? So why don't you all go ahead and submit some ideas. Five things, and you don't have to submit five, but just, you know, submit a handful of things that might be helpful in recovery for a survivor.
Support, legal advocacy, willing to listen. Having a friend for support, to be believed, have counseling available, have someone believe me, therapy, acceptance and support, someone to believe me, knowledge, justice. Non-judgment, understanding.
That's pretty good. So non-judgment, understanding, support, believing them. So again, here you are on the board. You've already asked people, why don't survivors report? And then, or why don't they tell people? Not even report, but why don't they tell people? And you've got that list. And then you've asked them to get more specific about that, the actual comments, the actual phrases, the actual things they see day to day. And then you ask this question. And again, so this would be kind of on another sheet of paper on the other side of the board. You would list the things that they say a survivor needs help to, that might be helpful to a survivor to recover. And at that point, what you've got on that board is a very, very, very simple visual for them of rape culture and what survivors go through. On the one side, you've got these ideas of why people don't report, or again, I keep saying reporting, why they don't come forward, why they don't tell people. On the other side, you've got the things that we know people need to find support. And the whole point of this exercise, is that they can visually see the disconnect between those two things. This sounds simplistic, but I want to just really say that this activity in a space where you are dealing with a potential resistant audience is a slam dunk for the most part. Because it's their own ideas that you're using here. What does a survivor need to recover? And then you point out the very things they're saying that they've heard around them, that they've seen around them, that don't allow that to happen. And the whole point is then to get them to move towards this idea of kind of intervening and doing something about that culture, about that environment. So ending rape culture requires we create a survivor supportive space or survivor supportive spaces. Realistically, that is not going to be rape crisis centers alone. I mean, we could staff every rape crisis center in this country to full capacity, times 10, you know, millions of dollars rushing into all of your centers. I know some of you were like, that would be awesome. And one day when I become a billionaire, I don't know how that's going to happen. I'm going to have to rob the Fed, I think. But when that happens, I promise to fund all of you fully. But I mean, think about that, right? Even if you had every rape crisis center in the country fully funded, fully staffed, at full capacity to do all their work, we would never, ever, ever end rape culture and victim blaming until people in their day-to-day lives were willing to take a step forward and do something about this. Right? There is no...
Can we pause for a question?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to get a little closer because I hear my sound isn't great. So
The question is, do you think that a male audience would be able to imagine being a survivor of rape for the purpose of that activity that you just did?
That's a great question. And my answer to that is yes. Actually, in my experience, most male audiences are actually able to imagine that quite well. And it's a simple question. I mean, you're not asking them to you know, put themselves in. I mean, you could take it a step further. You know, imagine you are a rape survivor. You could have them close their eyes and give a description of what they might be going through to kind of build some sort of connection or empathy with what survivors go through. But yes, I have done this with male audiences, and they don't struggle to actually answer that question all that much, because you're not defining a case or a specific survivor. You're just saying, if you were raped, and again, we're also not stipulating gender here, right? So, I mean, in that space, there are men who have been sexually assaulted and sexually abused, so they'll have ideas as well. I do think this works pretty, and I think I have done this with male audiences, and it does work well. And in fact, with resistant audiences like this, a group of men may not be willing to say that they're going to challenge other men about masculinity. But when it comes down to a basic idea of, do you want people who are raped to be able to get help? If someone you knew was sexually assaulted, would you want them to be able to turn to you to feel supported? Would you want to be able to help them? Would you want them to trust you to be able to help them? Overwhelmingly, the response is yes. Most people want that. Even the most angry and conservative-y or whatever people that would be resistant want that. And, you know, you can also remind them, you know, if they're kind of a distance from that, you could, again, read an example of a sexual assault, very simple, and kind of have them close their eyes and imagine they're just, you know, they don't want this person to touch them, they force themselves on them, and give a very simple sexual assault example, and then have them reflect on that. Another way to do it is to point out to all of the people in the room before you even begin this, and I do this often, is to say, just so you know, every single one of you knows a survivor of sexual assault. 100% guarantee you do. And if we're talking about sexual assault in the big picture, with childhood sexual abuse, I mean, certainly if you include, you know, intimate partner violence and stuff, I mean, everyone knows someone. And then what my follow-up to that is to say, you know, you just may not realize you know them. And why is that? Because they're afraid to tell you. Why are they afraid to tell you? And then you start off with the exercise again, right? And that gets them to think, wait, maybe, okay, so you're saying I do know someone. Maybe I don't believe you entirely, but if I did know someone, why would they not tell me? And that becomes very personal then when you get to this bystander intervention piece, which is to say, look, we all have an opportunity to create spaces where people feel safe to tell us stuff. I mean, realistically, first responders to sexual assault are not victim advocates. They are not law enforcement. They are not medical staff. First responders to sexual assault are cousins and best friends and moms, dads who are disclosed to, you know, and or someone wants to disclose to. I mean, there's much first responders as anyone else. And so, again, kind of that's the idea here, is that we can't leave this in the hands of just a handful of people to be providing that kind of support. We've got to create an environment where they feel supported. And the point of this juxtaposed activity, where you have why they wouldn't and then what they need, is to point out that all of the survivors are not going to just start disclosing to you. So like I said a moment ago, you could ask the question, you know, or say, sorry, state, all of you know a survivor, you just may not know. Why is that? It's not because you're necessarily bad people. It's not because you don't listen well, or at least for some of you, it's not that you don't listen well. It's because the people that you know who've been sexually assaulted are afraid to tell you. Why is that? And I'll give you another way to talk about that, which is to say, let's say, for example, you and a bunch of friends were sitting around. And you were having, you know, a family reunion or something, and you were looking at someone who was like, oh, my gosh, have you seen what's going on these college campuses? It's just so crazy. I just saw, you know, the Vanderbilt kid. It's just so crazy what's happening with, you know, rape today on those college campuses. And then someone in the room says something like, yeah, well, those kind of girls, you know, the kind of girls who go out and party like that, they are just asking for trouble. I mean, that's just the hard truth of it. They have to be safer. They are asking for trouble. Someone says that out loud, and you're sitting in the room. The survivor in the room, and there is a survivor in every room, clearly is most likely not going to think the person who just said that is safe. But if you're sitting in the room, and you don't speak up and challenge that idea that it's the victim's fault, guess who else becomes unsafe? And the answer to that is them. They become unsafe. And this is a very simple way, right? I mean, like, especially for, like, parents, you know? I mean, you would want your kid, most parents would say they'd want their kid to feel safe coming up and telling them something like that. Not all, but most. And that's an important thing to point out. You can't just assume that they will feel safe. You could even make a kind of somewhat of a comparison here to, you know, someone coming out of the closet around their sexual orientation or their gender identity. And you know, people aren't just going to start disclosing, hey, by the way, I'm gay, to everyone. You have to show them that you're safe to talk to about that. You've got to, if someone's being homophobic in the room and you don't speak up against that, they're going to think you're not safe either because you seem to agree with the other person. So I'm not sure if that entirely answered that question, but I hope it did some. Okay, so we'll plug along here. So coming back to our rape prone environment graphic here. So we've kind of covered that blame and support one. I'm not going to go into a rumors activity. I'm going to skip us all the way over to this one, to language, and play with language for just a minute here. So language matters. I mean, on a very simple level, language matters. And to kind of give you, you know, a simple example of this, right, is that the language is the way that we think. So simple exercise for you right now. It's kind of, you know, basic communication studies here. I would like you all right now to sit where you are and try to think, but not use any language. On your mark, get set, go. Okay, if anyone has figured out how to do that, please notify us immediately, because that's a relatively impossible thing to do. Now, some of you may be thinking, well, okay, I just thought of something in my head. I saw a color, right? But how did you know what it was? How did you figure out what it was? You just saw something in your head, but to think about it, you're going to use a word like, I saw red. It's a color. It's a thing. It's a shape. It's something. We use language to think, which means that language is not just words. It is the system through which we understand and perceive everything. So that said, this is something that I share a lot in, like, anti-bullying presentations. You know, this idea that sticks and stones may break your bones, but words will never hurt you. Words do just as much damage. In fact, sometimes they do even more damage than sticks and stones are capable of. And I think for a lot of you, actually, who do this work with survivors, this is a really readily apparent thing, that it's not necessarily even the physical trauma or the trauma just from the moment and the sexual assault itself. A lot of it is what happens afterwards when people say things around survivors that are just so awful and destructive and mean and terrible. This also applies to perpetrators, right, who operate in environments where terms like this are excessive, where terms around them, the language around them allows them to think and say, what I'm doing is acceptable, and everyone else does it too. So I just saw this graphic, and I kind of liked it, right, that bullying leaves a mark. And I find this interesting because I want to kind of, I'm using bullying here as an example, because what I want to point out is this is not just about sexual assault. That when you think of, when I ask you, what are the most common phrases, the common things people do and say, like what's the most common way someone gets bullied, gets abused by someone else in any format? And the answer to that is they get called names, they get made fun of, language is thrown at them. And when we drill down and say what kind of language is most likely to be used, typically it's something that describes that person's identity. Or about their identity in particular, their gender or gender identity, gender performance, their sexual orientation, their race or ethnicity, their physical or cognitive ability or disability, and all of the things that come with that. And so the value of understanding that, from my perspective, is that if we're talking about rape culture, this is maybe the biggest piece of all. Because media, victim blaming, all of it, we use language to think about it, and then we talk about it with other people. So what I want to ask you to do right now is I'm going to ask you what I think is a simple question. I'm going to ask you a question here and have you respond. For male identified people, what do you think is going to be the most common thing that someone would say to them, someone would call them to put them down, to make them feel less, to make them feel inferior, to tease or humiliate them? You can just submit your thoughts there.
Pussy. B and P words. fag, girl, weak. Uh,
Girly. Okay, so we've got a lot of words there. And you tell me, I mean, you all just thought this up. Does that not fit with what I said a moment ago? The most common things that were going to be used to put someone down, right, as a guy, are going to be based on gender and sexual orientation. And what you just threw out is exactly that. And it is the most common way that men are humiliated and abused. Simple question here for you. If these words float around any environment, let's say your community, let's say specifically a high school in your community, if those words float around and a young boy is sexually abused or assaulted, is he more or less likely to think he's safe to come forward when those words are floating around? And I'm not even going to let you, we're not going to even have to pull that one. The obvious answer is not safe, yeah? You also notice that the words there, if you haven't caught on to that yet, I'm sure a lot of you have, but the words there when we put men down, bitch, pussy, like a girl, all relate men back to women. So here's this thing for men, right, which is to say that our the worst thing we can be is like a girl, it's like a woman. And this is not, you know, commonly people think this is destructive. That's obviously hurtful to women, right? It creates an environment where women are just seen as less and devalued. The other thing it does, though, is it's not, so we're not just talking about that it's don't be a girl. It's that you can't do anything that is deemed feminine. And things that we deem feminine in our culture are not all negative. Some of them have some positive, you know, aspects to them. For example, being empathic or nurturing, right? Being able to express emotions. So if those things are not allowable for a guy to practice to do, then what we have is something where, again, it's not just that this devalues women, but it teaches men to basically take these pieces of ourselves that are healthy and helpful and to hide or subdue or suppress them so that we don't get called these names. We don't get seen that way. You know, if you were to think about a perpetrator operating in a space where these words are floating around, do you think they're more or less likely to think what they're doing is acceptable? In particular, when we think about the fact that when a guy is not sexually active, he's going to be called the very words that you all just submitted in that poll or in that chat, right? He's going to get called those words. You didn't hit that, man. You're such a little bitch. And when that kind of thing happens, for the perpetrator, right? It's this reminder. Yeah, real men, right? If I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do, and I'm using a male perpetrator here, but if I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do, I'm going to go get laid. And if I'm not, I am this awful, weak, terrible thing. And every other guy knows that they want the same thing. That's what real guys want. It becomes this kind of normative behavior. So let's do the opposite now, and we'll kind of go to women here, and I am using a gender binary just for expediency. I don't know why I say that. We're not going to do that. I'm changing that right now. If you are not cisgender, meaning if your gender representation is not that is clearly male or female, what do you think are words that you are going to get called?
Freak, loser, he, she, weirdo, what are you?
Yeah. And we almost feel bad reading these words out loud because they are just so painful. So again, looking at this, right, like what is it that freaks people, you know, that people freak out about and use as a way to bully others? And again, in this case, right, if your gender identity or gender presentation isn't obvious, we go back to this idea that you're a freak, you are a tranny, you are weird, or you get stereotyped as being, that your sexual orientation is connected to your gender performance. And so that starts to collapse. And again, in an environment like that, I mean, and literally a number of you wrote the word freak. So you tell me, is a freak someone who deserves the right to say no? Is a freak someone whose sexual choices are going to be respected? Is a freak someone who's going to feel safe coming forward when they are sexually assaulted? So now let's go kind of like onto the other side of the spectrum here, and we'll go to if women are going to be made fun of or bullied or teased, what are they going to get? What are they going to be called? Have you submit that in your chat box there? So some again, pretty common responses there. Slut, whore, bitch, tease. So lots of different phrases there. Again, interestingly enough, right, all around gender, sexual practice, sexual orientation. And obviously, you know, there are other things that would come up depending on the person and their identity, how others wanted to treat them, but we're back at this place. Now, again, that word slut, for example, you know, I talk about this word a lot because I think that at its core, it might be one of the most damaging things to, one of the most damaging pieces of rape culture that exists. Because at its core, the idea of a slut, I mean, the word gets applied to everyone. If you've seen me present before, you've heard me talk about this, but that when we talk about who gets called a slut, I mean, this is, by the way, a very simple activity to conduct. What does a woman do to get called a slut? And you are going to get very standard responses. She sleeps around. I then ask, how much, how often, what does that mean? And people will shout out, once is what I got yesterday at Madison High School. So if you are just sexual once, you are a slut. If other places, I'll get like four or six, you know. And the numbers are random, and that's kind of the point, is to have them shouting out these random things. What else does a slut do? She doesn't, she dresses a certain way. We prompt them, what do you mean she dresses provocatively? What does that even mean? And then they start putting out these random things, like her skirt is short, her butt's hanging out of her skirt. I'm like, how often do you actually see someone where you see their butt hanging out of their skirt? And they're like, you would be surprised more often than you think. They show cleavage, they wear something tight, or it's too sexy. Well, what else is a woman going to call the slut for? Well, she can get called a slut for flirting. She can get called a slut for not flirting. She can get called a slut for talking about being interested in hooking up with someone. She can be called a slut for having more than one guy friend at a time. She can be called a slut for basically anything, including just being born naked, right? when we think about this, so the point of that exercise is to then ask them, how many women does this term apply to? And the answer is all or darn close to all women. The next thing we ask in that, or that I ask in this exercise, we're just trying to get them to understand the power of language, is to say, well, what for a slut, you know, what did, we don't really agree on what a slut is. That's the whole kind of point of the first part. It's really vague and ambiguous deliberately so that it can easily be applied to lots of women, right? That's a way to control women's sexuality, to make them feel bad, oppress, all of those kind of things. And then we have the second question, which is, okay, but as a culture, if we were to define a slut, we were say there's something we agree that sluts is consistent about sluts, and it's that they don't deserve something. And you wait about 2 or 3 seconds, and inevitably the responses are respect and love. So we take that for a moment and put together a little logic model and say, okay, so what you've just said is all women are sluts, and sluts don't deserve respect. Just keep repeating that. All women are sluts. And sluts don't deserve respect. All women are sluts. Sluts don't deserve respect. And the follow-up question to that is, what are we actually saying? And what we're saying really is that all women don't deserve respect. Here's a follow-up trick for you to use if that doesn't satisfy your audience. Ask this question. Have them fill in the blank on this sentence. That slut got what she... And what do you think they're going to answer? I'll let you type that into your box there. That slut got what she...
deserved.
you can, and they can't.
Change,
yeah, there was. Yeah. There's a tense. We had present tense and past tense. Deserved, asked for, wanted, deserved, asked for. And this is consistent. And people can answer this instantaneously. And that is a really critical point for us to make, right, around our culture, because this word gets thrown around constantly. There are more vile words even than this that get thrown around constantly, but this word is used constantly in the United States. regardless of age, almost, regardless of gender, and regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of community and ethnicity. This word gets thrown around constantly everywhere. And so one of the things that we want to point out, right, is like what we're literally saying is that if there is some type of woman, and which type of woman? Well, basically any woman the perpetrator decides, because we've left the definition of slut so vague that anyone gets to choose what and who someone, you know, when someone is a slut, and that those people don't deserve respect, right? I mean, like, that slut got what she deserved. In other words, that some women deserve to be hurt. Some women deserve to be abused. Some women deserve to be sexually assaulted, all of those things. And so this is just kind of like an exercise that I use constantly with all kinds of audiences, and is a really useful tool. I found to be a really useful tool for discussing the power of language. Because when we boil this down, the word slut is not a word. It is a system through which we literally encourage perpetrators to think that some women deserve what's happening to them, and tell survivors that some women deserve what is happening to them. And in that environment, we are never going to end rape. We are never going to have more survivors coming forward, or we're going to have less survivors coming forward. It becomes really difficult to do something about that. And here's the other catch to this, why I find this so valuable and think it's so important, is because this is an easily changeable behavior. You don't need to ask them to become full-time advocates. You don't need to ask them to, you know, constantly be talking to their friends about this stuff. We can literally just say, don't ever use that word again. You want to end rape and help survivors feel supported. Don't use that word ever again. And if you feel like you can, try to get other people you know to not use it either. And that, again, sometimes when I talk about this, people say, that sounds really trivial. But I want you to really think about what I'm suggesting. If that word and words like it were used 50% less often in your environment, in your community, you tell me if you think that more survivors would come forward. Tell me if you think some young perpetrators would think maybe a little bit differently about what they're about to do, or what kind of women might deserve this. You tell me what would happen on that jury in San Diego if that idea of slut was something we were disgusted by, that we recognized was just some sort of myth that is designed to make rapists seem legit. What would have happened on that 8-4 jury split if that word and those jurors really thought that word was messed up and that people shouldn't use it? And I'll put this quote up in front of you. The late Maya Angelou had this quote: people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. People will not forget how you made them feel. And I just find this quote to be really poignant when it comes to language and the power of language. I mean, they may forget exactly what you said, but there's not a survivor around that forgets how they felt when someone said they were being a slut and that's why they got hurt. There's not a perpetrator around who heard that word and didn't feel empowered by it and be like, yeah, man, that's what some girl, you know, that's what some girls deserve. It's a really powerful notion and idea to me. Okay, so plugging along here, we've made our way through our pretty diagram here. We're now on consent. So some simple things around consent here. So some of you have seen me do this activity before, and I just want to kind of throw it up here and actually point out that part of what I think is really important to talk about when we discuss consent is not to start off with definitions of consent, is not to decide, you know, just go straight to consent, but is actually to have a conversation about sex first. Because part of rape culture, and it's not on that diagram, part of rape culture is the way that we talk about and think about sex. But the way that our culture speaks about sex, the shaming around sexual behaviors that we do, the way that we think of sex as something that's supposed to be really, you know, hot and spontaneous, all of those things really contribute to a rape culture. They contribute to environments where sexual practices aren't really sexual practices anymore. They're coercive practices. Because coercion, when we look around our culture, is a big part of how people think sex is sexy. So there's a lot of different ways to do this. Carol and I designed this grid years and years and years ago because we were trying to get people to understand that there's lots of ways to be sexual, but there's something different about sexual assault, something different about sexual violence. And so in kind of getting these ideas about sex, I want to show you a couple of like images here. So if we were to go through our culture and kind of look at representations of sex and sexuality, we see some pretty consistent things. First up here, you can see that sex is only, in popular culture in particular, is apparently only available to young people. Once you get past the age of 40, no more sex for you. It's kind of a bummer. You can see the right. You can see the bodies of these people, right, and the consistency in the way your body's supposed to be. And this is important because the idea here is that if your body isn't as hot as it could be, your sex life will not be as hot as it could be. That attractive people are going to have a better sex life. So that we become our whole sexual practice then becomes in part centered around the idea of, are we sexy or attractive enough to the person we're with? And if we're making comparisons with popular culture, that becomes a very hard thing to believe that we are sexy or hot enough. Though some of you may think, and may be sexy and hot and in your, never mind, you know what I'm trying to say. But I look up here and see some other things, right? I mean, people, you know, it's kind of like, it's very hot and it's passionate and it's intense. You've got, you know, it can be romantic and swept off your feet, like The Notebook. That black and white image, it's very bendy. People in pop culture, very bendy. Not sure if you ever noticed this. And I'm sure some of you have noticed this. I certainly had in my life where, you know, you see something in media or popular culture or read something in a book about sex and you try that out and it does not work as planned. And you realize you were not as bendy as the people that were on TV earlier. And then there's the Titanic effect. You can see the hand there, right? The slam on the window and the steam is down the side. That is you know, the kind of, you know, pop culture idea about sex. And I'm sure that is exactly what all of your sexual experiences have been exactly like, right? Just perfectly bendy, passionate, you know, hot and steamy. And I'm putting this out in part because, like, some of this is not just about sexual assault, but it's about the environment that sexual assault happens in. And when we learn to kind of compare what sex should be to this fictitious world and our cultural ideas about sex, inevitably we experience disappointment, right, with our own sexual experiences. So if your sexual experiences aren't the most hot and steamy things ever, you're like, well, that was a bummer. Let me give you another example. So I don't know if I'm hoping this will work and you can get the sound on this. If not, we're going to switch our sound here. See if we can get this one to work. So I'll narrate. This is from the Thomas Crown Affair, the remake of this. I find this kind of hilarious, right? So he asked her, like, oh, you can hear it?
Yeah.
Oh, good, okay. Never mind, I'll shut up.
No, I hear you.
Oh, you hear me? Oh, okay. All right, so.
Narration,
right, here we go. So this narration, right? They are being very sexy right now, as you can see. I am sure most of you think, you know where I want to have sex is a marble staircase. There'd be nothing more comfortable than a cold marble staircase to be sexual with someone. You can see the visual representations here, I mean, are pretty hokey and cheesy, right? You know, the cut from her, you know, her body to the, you know, and her breasts are exposed. And then check, wait for it. There it is. Right, I mean, just some really cheesy visual representation here, right? And so we go through this, and I just want you to watch, like, this is supposed to be hot, it's supposed to be sexy, right? In the scene with these two attractive actors, it's supposed to be really amazing. She right now is pouring water on him and saying, you don't think we're done now, do you? Right, because apparently in pop culture world, right, people have sex for, like, hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. Where in real life, we have jobs and other things to do besides have sex constantly. But I mean, you can see, right? I mean, like, the way that he carries her off there, who's initiating sex and sexuality, whose sex and sexuality is more valued, who's, you know, the way that bodies are objectified. This is my favorite, right? They push her on the desk. I don't know about you all, but, like, if you threw me on a desk while we were having sex and all my books hit the ground, we would stop and I would have to start picking up the books. be like, I literally had just stacked those yesterday. Right? And I mean, so, like, playing a clip like this is just one way of kind of looking at it, right? But this is kind of like the hot and sexy thing. I'm not going to play the clip from Friends with Benefits in particular because we're having trouble with the sound, but if you've seen Friends with Benefits, there's a very cute scene between Justin Timberlake and Mia Kunitz, who are preparing to have sex for the first time. And so in this, the Thomas Crown Affair, this is meant to be sexy, kind of hot, attractive. In Friends with Benefits, they actually have a conversation about what they do and don't like right before they have sex for the first time. And it's a very cute scene, but it's funny, and we're laughing. So what's interesting about this, right, if you juxtapose these two movies with each other, is the one that's supposed to be sexy is the one where there is no communication, there is no clear consent. And then the other one is where there is clear consent and clear communication about what their sexual practices are and what they would like and how they'd like to be touched. We laugh, and it's meant as a comedy. I'll share, I don't know if I can try to share this ad with you next. This is an Axe body spray ad.
Try turning the volume up on your computer.
Okay. The volume was up. Oh.
It's muted. Keep going.
We don't need to hear the sound for this one. Right. Works at that. Yeah, the entire office is now spraying itself with Axe body spray. Just for. Yeah. So, I mean, this ad, I want to come back to this, right? We talk about animals, right? Animals, and that idea that. What? Okay. That idea that sex and in popular culture in particular, right, that sex is supposed to be this really spontaneous, passionate thing. And again, this ad really just reinforces that concept that here they are in a grocery store and that's where it happens because he smells like Axe body spray. And they just, I mean, they derobe. It's like, it's out of our control. And again, I think that's a, you know, we look at the way that we talk about sex, the way we think about sex, sexuality in our culture, that idea that it is animalistic and out of our control and so passionate and so intense. While we might experience that passion, we might experience that intensity, when we talk about it and think about it that way, we really do fuel an idea that it is out of our control to some extent. And for a perpetrator, right, that is like perpetration 101. I want to do something, and I'm supposed to be able to do it, and sex is just something that happens. So, like, I initiate it, I do what I want, it doesn't really matter what the other person wants, because, like, sex just happens, and if they don't stop it, it's because they're into it, too. I mean, it just fuels an idea where sex is not something where we communicate, where sex is out of our control, which, as many of you are probably familiar, is probably the single oldest rape defense ever used for male perpetrators, right, that men are out of control. Yeah. Where are we? Okay, go away. All right, so we're back to this grid, and I just want to kind of show you how we do this next. So, you know, we'll go through and I'll ask people what these different kinds of sex are, and then eventually we make our way to what is the kind of key point of this whole exercise, which is to talk about the difference between sex and sexual assault. And the way that we do that is to say, let's look at what the difference here is. That a lot of people think this fits, like that rape is just part of what sex is and that it's a bad kind of sex, really bad. And our point here is that it's not even sex. And the difference is that with all these different kinds of sex, good and sloppy and bad and regretted, that you make a choice to engage in that activity. You get to choose to do it. I mean, the whole point of regretted sex being you regret your choice. So you get to choose. And with rape, you don't get to choose. You know, I've heard a lot of people just, you know, on college campuses right now, there's a lot of stuff where you'll see people talking about non-consensual sexual activity. And what I'd like to remind people of is that consensual sex is a redundant statement. It's redundant, because if it's consensual, it's sex, and if it's not, it's rape. And that's a really valuable way, I think, to talk to people about this, and particularly even when you're working with survivors, right, who are struggling with what happened and the experiences they had, contextualizing what the difference here is, right, that when there's not consent, this is not some sort of, you know, if you didn't choose to do this, this is no longer a sexual activity, this is an abusive violation of someone else. So when I see college campuses' policies that say they have, you know, that non-consensual sexual activity, I'm like, why don't you just call that rape? Because that's what that is. Right? Non-consensual sexual activity is rape. That is what that means, and we should call it that. So it's kind of like talking about consent and how we discuss that. And then, here we go. We're on kind of our last one here, which is on that idea of oppression and objectification and dehumanization. And I'm going to use popular culture right now because that's an easy way for me to kind of share this with you. And I'd encourage you to feel like enabled and empowered to use this as well. Here you've got, and this stuff is easy to find, you know. So here we've got this split screen. And on the left, you've got this woman called the It Girl. On the right, we've got Indiana Jones. And this was a actual, like the magazine of Maxim just opened up onto these pages. And when we look at the juxtaposition of these two things, it becomes very clear which group is experiencing oppression and which group is not. It also becomes very clear, like, the It Girl, what makes her the It Girl? I mean, look at the way that she's kind of, like, her body's positioned, right? physically, her body, again, very thin. The way she's looking at, you know, the male viewer here is very kind of like, come have sex with me right now, or what Gail Dines calls the, I'll be with the F me face. Gail Dines, if you don't know her, she's awesome. You should check her out. But that's, I mean, like, that's what she's doing. And then literally right next door is, your revolver holds 6 bullets, but your fists never run out of ammo. And so you get this kind of idea of, like, male power and female submissiveness. And again, at Madison West yesterday, the students there in the men's and women's club, actually, they talked about this. They talked about the idea of, like, men are, you know, the stereotypes that men are supposed to be in control and dominant, women are taught to be submissive. And they were talking to their own peers about how stupid that is and how messed up that is. When we point it out to people, it's not hard for them to get, and then they can start talking about it themselves. The root of violence is oppression, and oppression, instead of getting into like kind of an academic way of thinking about it, we could just do it simply and say oppression is where someone is kind of pressed down, yeah, where they are just held down by a system or a group of people, and that is at the core of what fuels violence, because when we see people as less, again, it becomes easier to hurt them. That's where the cycle happens. So I'll just ask you, you know, can you think of anywhere in our culture where that is the case? I don't know. By the way, I do yoga even, and I would never stand on my tippy toes to bend over. That just makes no sense at all when you look at the image in the middle. But the whole thing, right? I mean, like, look at the way her body is positioned, right? I mean, that's a beer advertisement. That is actually a shoe ad on the right, by the way. They're actually trying to sell a shoe. You can see that. And if you're not familiar, that is Rachel Ray on the bottom left, posed in FHM magazine. Rachel Ray, the TV talk show host and 30 Minute Meal star, posed in this and said in her interview about doing this these posts that she wanted young girls to see that they could do anything they wanted in their life, and they didn't have to have a perfect body to be sexual. I find that picture kind of hilarious because I'm not sure what she's doing to the spoon, but it just looks pretty awkward. We've got Kim Kardashian in the right. You know, I mean, and the imagery is so consistent, right? And so, again, just when we're talking about rape culture, you can literally, and you don't have to do this fancy-wise. You don't have to do it as a PowerPoint. Go to the grocery store. Buy a magazine like Cosmo. Take the magazine into the room where you're going to talk to people and have them tear out anything they see that might make it seem like women are supposed to be submissive, that they're supposed to be docile, that they are objects, that they are sexualized. And you'll have a quarter of the magazine torn out within 5 minutes. And it just goes on and on and on, right? It's a pretty consistent theme. Jessica Simpson up here, who was Housewife of the Year in 2006 because she apparently enjoys to Swiffer in her high heels and panties. That was in 2006. So it's getting a little old now, but I mean, just kind of the concept that in 2006, that's what made someone Housewife of the Year. Danica Patrick, the woman on the bottom, is the first woman to ever win an Indy car race. She's also the only woman to ever compete in Daytona. When you Google image search her, this is what comes up. And for men, we get this kind of flip side imagery. Tough, aggressive, strong, dominant, powerful, unemotional, unless that emotion is anger, almost inhuman, robotic at times. Talented, competitive, strong, invincible. And I'm sure a lot of you can identify for a lot of men. I mean, how many of you have known a man who was injured or hurt but wouldn't go get help because he didn't want to be seen as weak or soft, a bitch or a pussy, that he was living up to this kind of image? She is a thing of beauty. This was on a billboard, and it always kind of fascinated me, right? She is a thing of beauty. They're talking about the beer, but they're not talking about the beer. Yeah? You may have seen these before. The one on the left has her, and it says Jane on her, it's posted on her forehead. And the one on the right, her face has been replaced by a car, so he's screwing an object while thinking about an object. And the way that women and their bodies are used, the way that women are prizes and rewards for men, this is a culture of oppression. This is a space where rape is going to flourish. You know, look at Hugh in the middle of, you know, sitting in that chair with his, you know, the girls next door are sitting there with them. Just kind of powerful imagery. This one is from 2001. It's going to be a little bit older, but this one has always kind of floored me, like conquer her. Like, you know, it's Poland in 1938 or something. It's kind of like a powerful image here, spread, conquer, dominate, be in charge. I want to add these two as well, because when we're talking about oppression, we are not just talking about issues of sexism and homophobia. We are also talking about issues of race, and ethnicity, and ability, and disability. It would be naive for us to assume that in a society where racism is a kind of readily accepted practice, that doesn't affect victimization, in particular around sexual assault. There's a long, long history of sexual assault and racism going really, really well, hand in hand. Violence against women is just normalized on a regular basis. Many of you, I'm sure, have seen that image. You may not have seen this one. It's basically the same thing, just Calvin Klein a few years later. Sex becomes violent, violence becomes sexy. And so here, after our 90 minutes, we come back to this kind of this idea, right, that there's all these different pieces that contribute to a rape-prone environment. And what I'm hoping that you all may be able to take from this is an opportunity to just use any little piece of what we talked about today and insert it somewhere into a conversation. And it doesn't even have to be a professional conversation, but insert it into some space that you occupy. Because what we have to do is dismantle this one piece at a time. We're not going to be able to get to it all in one day. We're not going to be able to get to it all in one curriculum. We have to kind of just keep chipping away, right, at this giant problem. But if all of us actively chip away at this and get other people to start chipping away, we get to a place where we have the opportunity to really make change and make this disappear. As a final story here, I want to kind of tell you how powerful this is. So Brianna is a student who I met a number of years ago who had never really talked about rape culture or thought about it before, and then we had a conversation, and then she was one of my students at some point. And Brianna worked at some food place on campus, and she was while working there, she was having a conversation with a group of her friends, and one of them said something to the effect of, "Well, you know, some girls kind of set themselves up for this stuff. I mean, I'm not saying it's their fault, but some girls set themselves up." Brianna, having had conversations about what rape culture is, having had these dialogues before, literally just starts to say, "You know, I don't really think of it that way. Here's why." Has a very calm conversation, no argument. So below her is the person who said that thing, who, after she speaks, goes, okay, I see your point. Not everyone will agree. But here's the part that I think is more powerful. She has this conversation, and you see the top line there, the next person there, is one of her other coworkers, who the next day came back and told Brianna, that she went home, her coworker went home, and talked about what Brianna said to one of her friends. That friend, for the first time in 6 months, disclosed that she was sexually assaulted 6 months prior. She then goes online, gets resources, and now that survivor is getting resources and assistance, right? That trickle effect. And then the other coworker, we're not even sure what they heard or who they talked to, but just kind of as a reminder that this isn't all going to happen at once, but that we can kind of make this happen. It's just going to have to be one little action, one little step at a time. But we've got to start talking about the environment that allows rape to happen so that other people can talk about the environment that allows rape to happen. So I think we're actually out of time here, though. That's okay. So I will thank you all for attending today. This is our website. You can certainly look us up. And obviously, the WCASA is the reason I'm here and doing this. So if you liked it, high five to them. If you didn't, it's my fault. And it's been great spending the last 90 minutes with you all.
Awesome. Thanks, everyone, for joining. We will be getting a recording up and resources and things like that shortly. But in the meantime, thank you very much, and have a